When I was a girl growing up, I don't remember being taught about the Holy Spirit. And I was raised in a committed Christian home where my parents loved Jesus, obeyed Jesus, served Jesus, where God the Father was worshiped in reverence and fear, but I just don't remember being taught about the Holy Spirit. And when I went to church, and I went to church every Sunday, the Holy Spirit was referred to as the Holy Ghost, and he was only mentioned in benedictions when the pastor would bless us in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, or at weddings when he would pronounce a young couple man and wife in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost, or at baptisms when he would baptize people in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. And ghost was a little off-putting to me, just, you know, I didn't feel comfortable with a ghost, and so I neglected the Holy Spirit. It wasn't until I was a young adult studying the scriptures for myself that I came to understand more fully who he is. And I wonder if you, too, are confused about the Holy Spirit. Maybe you don't know about him at all. Maybe things you've heard about him are off-putting to you. And so I think it's worth our while to get to know him as the Bible reveals that he is. And the night that Jesus was betrayed, the night before he was crucified, he gathered with his disciples in the upstairs room, and I want us to join them. It was after he had had supper with his disciples, he had washed their feet, he dismissed Judas, and then do you remember he was teaching his disciples, and he taught them about heaven, that in my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I'm going to come again to receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And I love Thomas's response to that, Lord, we don't know where you're going, so we don't know how to get there. And that provoked the incredible response from Jesus. Thomas, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one will come to the Father except they come through me. And then he taught them in John 15, he taught them that I am the vine and you are the branches. Without me, you can't do anything. He taught them about persecution, that if the world hates me, it's going to hate you. And the disciples reclining around that table in the upstairs room, they were beginning to get the picture. Jesus was leaving. And I think in their spirits, they were crying out, oh no, you can't leave us. And they were getting the impression that they were going to be responsible for his ministry in his visible absence. And so I think there was a strong resistance to being overwhelmed with that load of responsibility. And so it was at that moment that Jesus taught them about the Holy Spirit. And if you have your Bible, would you turn in your Bible to the Gospel of John chapter 16? And I want you to read with me what Jesus taught his disciples in that upstairs room on that night that he was betrayed about the Holy Spirit. And I won't be reading this passage every time we gather, but this will be the passage that our study will be based on. So from now on, I'll refer to a verse perhaps from this passage, but in this opening session, I want to read the entire thing to you. So in John chapter 16, verse 5, Jesus said, "Now I'm going to him who sent me, yet none of you asked me, 'Where are you going?' Because I've said these things, you're filled with grief. But I tell you the truth, it's for your good that I'm going away." And just stop for a moment and listen to what Jesus is saying. He's saying, it's for your good that I'm going away. How could that be? Then he answers in the next phrase, "Unless I go away, the counselor will not come to you. But if I go, I'll send him to you." In other words, it would be better to have Jesus visibly absent in order to have the Holy Spirit invisibly present. That's amazing. Verse 8, "When he comes, he will convict the world of guilt in regard to sin, righteousness, and judgment." Slipping down to verse 12, "I have much more to say to you, more than you can now bear. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak on his own. He will speak only what he hears, and he will tell you what is yet to come. He will bring glory to me by taking from what is mine and making it known to you. All that belongs to the Father is mine. That's why I said the Spirit will take from what is mine and make it known to you. In a little while, you will see me no more. Then after a little while, you will see me." And just to pause for a moment on that last verse, because it's an amazing thing that Jesus is saying, and I wonder if he's referring to after the resurrection. Do you remember when he suddenly appeared to Mary Magdalene at the empty tomb, and then he suddenly disappeared? He suddenly appeared to the women as they were going to Jerusalem, and then he suddenly disappeared. He suddenly appeared to the disciples in the upstairs room, and then he suddenly disappeared. And he suddenly appeared to the disciples walking to Emmaus, and then he suddenly disappeared. And he suddenly appeared beside the Sea of Galilee, and then he suddenly disappeared. All this coming and going. Now you see me, now you don't. And I think what he was doing was teaching his disciples about the Holy Spirit, that whether they could see Jesus or not, he was invisibly present with them 24/7 in the person of the Holy Spirit.